All right, everyone. So today we are going to walk you through the NVIDIA earnings report that just dropped for Q4 FY24. So buckle up, we're going to walk you through everything you must know in the next few minutes. And so I'm Bertrand and I'm the founder of App Economy Insights.
And I'm Stephanie Wong, AI product leader and creator.
And as you can see, we dress for the occasion, or both in green today.
Yeah, I know. I literally have one green shirt that's actually the perfect shade of green for NVIDIA. So I was like, there's no better occasion than to wear it for this earnings report review, right?
That's right. So we are going to look at the P&L that was just released by the company. And so we'll walk you through really the main talking points that you should know. But maybe, Steph, you want to start with one of the quotes from Jensen?
That's right. There is this great quote from Jensen Huang. Accelerated computing and generative AI have hit the tipping point. Demand is surging worldwide across companies, industries, and nations. And on top of that, Huang continues to see three massive tailwinds for NVIDIA. So the first is the transition from general purpose to accelerated computing. Second being, of course, generative AI. And the third, a whole new industry, as illustrated by ChatGPT, Midjourney, Gemini.
Yep. And so maybe as we cover data center, which you're going to see is basically now 83% of NVIDIA's revenue, and that's up from 80% last quarter.
Yeah. So to understand the compute needed for AI, you have to understand training versus inference. AI systems operate through two core stages, training and inference training. So imagine an AI as a student learning from the vast data around it, right? In this phase, AI develops the intelligence and pattern recognition, and NVIDIA dominates the segment with its robust graphics processing units, accelerating that learning process. And then you have inference, which is post-learning. AI applies this newfound knowledge to real-world scenarios and decision-making. It's basically when you send a request to a model, it has to make the prediction. NVIDIA here faces stiffer competition from companies like Intel, Qualcomm, and big tech in this category, but the company is making significant progress here too.
Yep. One thing that people have commented on is that surge in revenue for data center that NVIDIA is generating comes primarily from training. However, the big reveal from this quarter's call was that Jensen Huang revealed that 40%, in fact, of their AI revenue for data center in the past year has been from inference. And so it does show that not only the training of all those large language models is going to continue to grow just for the sheer demand, but over time, inference is going to really take over that data center revenue most likely, right? And so if you look at the revenue streams, we keep focusing on data center, and for good reason. When you look at this chart that breaks down the revenue over the past 3 years, essentially, you can see right away, right, that NVIDIA is very much the same company outside of data center, but that's really data center that went up more than 4x, right, in the past year, while gaming is going basically through the ups and down of seasonality and market demand. So really, that's why we want to focus on data center in this video. And so when we think about data center, a key aspect that Colette Kress, the CFO, highlighted on the call is the key customers for data center.
So there are three primary types of customers for data center. The first being cloud service providers, which contributed roughly half of data center revenue in previous quarters. All the hyperscalers like Amazon, Microsoft, Google are NVIDIA customers. Then you have consumer internet companies. They have been the second largest category this year. And in Meta's latest earnings, they shared a massive investment in 350,000 H100s from NVIDIA, which was an investment of over $10 billion. And then you have enterprise demand for AI and accelerated computing, and that touches all sectors. Leading software companies like Adobe, Databricks, and Snowflake are all adding AI copilots to their platforms, and adoption is far-reaching across other industries like automotive, healthcare, and finance.
When you look at that very big data center revenue stream, right, that comes in. So that revenue was up 27% quarter over quarter, right? We don't even look at year over year. It doesn't even make sense anymore. It's like more than 400% up year over year. But that happened despite the fact that NVIDIA is facing US restrictions on exports to China on advanced chips. They can still ship the low end, but they have seen a huge decline in their revenue coming from China. Used to be 20 to 25% of their data center revenue coming from China. And right now it's in the mid single digits. So it goes to show that the demand is really through the roof everywhere outside of China to compensate for that shortfall.
Beyond data center, there are other revenue segments like gaming, which was flat sequentially, but up 56% year over year and ahead of expectations. The segment actually doubled compared to pre-COVID, and the channel inventory levels improved in the past year. The launch of the G4 RTX 40 Super Series family of GPUs also contributed to this. Management highlighted an install base of over 100 million RTX PCs. You also have professional visualization, which accelerated to 11% sequentially, driven by higher demand for workstation GPUs based on the Ada Lovelace architecture. And automotive accelerated 8% sequentially from 3% last quarter. Nearly 80 automakers use NVIDIA's AI structure for autonomous driving and other applications.
So next, I wanted to touch on margins. You can see that the gross margin was 76%. That was 2 percentage points up from last quarter. And more importantly, that was 1.5 percentage points ahead of their guidance. And so they keep beating their profitability guidance. Same for operating margin, it was 62%. Good luck finding another company right now that has this kind of operating margin. That was up 4 percentage points quarter over quarter. And again, this is what really is striking with NVIDIA right now. This is going to bring a ton of competition. Again, they are supply constrained, right? They cannot ship more product. They are just doing their best to try to fulfill demand that is way above what they can handle, right? So that goes to show in the margins, they just like ship products and they don't stop.
Now moving on to investments. As part of their quarterly 13F filing, NVIDIA discloses their public investments. Arm Holdings, the largest stake, it was $147 million. And this is an investment in the UK chip designer. So far, it looks like that was a pretty smart move. Arm surged 58% after its latest earnings report. Why? A massive revenue beat and guidance raise combined with AI optimism.
Yep. It really surprised Wall Street. I think like people are still digesting whether it makes sense that Arm is up so much. But here we are, right? And so going back to the list from the 13F filing, there was a few small investments below $4 million. I do want to highlight one that was pretty big in a Recursion Pharmaceutical, that ticker symbol RXRX. So that's an investment they announced last summer for $50 million. It has already grown to $75 million. So that's a small biotech company. And they essentially like let them use NVIDIA DGX Cloud to train their AI models. They are basically using a super huge data set focused on drug discovery. So what they do really is they use BioNeMo, which is NVIDIA's cloud platform for drug discovery. And that's a way to essentially like invest in a company that directly uses your service. So really that investment is somewhat similar to the way Amazon and Google invested in Anthropic, and then in turn Anthropic is using their cloud infrastructure. So there is a little bit of that dynamic here.
Huang also touched on three critical elements of NVIDIA's growth strategy hitting their stride. First being CPUs, NVIDIA is expanding its reach into the cloud computing market, making its products available to a broader audience. There's also networking. So one product, InfiniBand, is positioned as the networking of AI factories, and it now exceeds $10 billion annualized revenue run rate with adoption in high performance computing. And we have software and services. It's on track to exit the year at a run rate of $1 billion. It's kind of like the rise of services of Apple. NVIDIA's rising software revenue will be critical to add predictability and durability to this business.
Moving on, we have to talk about the elephant in the room, which is the valuation of NVIDIA. I know it's a sensitive topic. I keep seeing chart crimes on X or elsewhere that kind of touch on aligning, you know, the stock chart of NVIDIA with the one of Cisco back in the 90s to kind of illustrate the point that probably in a bubble, it's probably about to crash by 90% or something like that. One thing that's one of my pet peeves, if we are going to compare these two companies, let's focus on the fundamentals. And that's really the only part that matters. Stock charts mean nothing in a vacuum. And so when we focus on the comparison to Cisco, I think we have to really recenter the debate on what is favoring NVIDIA right now, and can they durably sustain that massive growth that we are seeing in that transition they call to accelerated computing. And so the two key moats that we should highlight here is, number one, the switching costs, because you have proprietary software like CUDA that is critical for AI tools, so that's going to play a role here. But the other one is something that they touched on in the call multiple times, which is the network effects, right? We have an ecosystem around NVIDIA, the compatibility between partners that use NVIDIA's ecosystem. So the more people use NVIDIA's product, the better they get, the more valuable being part of that ecosystem matters, right? So that's something that could maintain that edge that NVIDIA has built in the past year. Ultimately, NVIDIA will rise and fall based on the capital expenditures or CapEx that the big cloud companies like Amazon, like Microsoft and Google decide to spend on data center. And eventually NVIDIA's revenue and earnings will fluctuate based on that, and the valuation will follow. So it will depend on things that are unpredictable, which is that demand, if we project 3-5 years down the line, because we know that the next 2 years really look bright. One thing that I do want to highlight is the projected revenue for NVIDIA. So you can see here FY24. This is data from FactSet, published by the Wall Street Journal. And analysts were projecting $60 billion for FY24 that just ended in January 24. Well, they were wrong. It turns out it's $61 billion. So they keep coming short, right, of the real numbers that come in, because this management team has under-promised and over-delivered quite consistently. And so who knows, right, for FY25, FY26, if those numbers are still very conservative or not. But if NVIDIA can really cross, you know, $100 billion in revenue, in annual revenue by FY26, so again, by January 26, there is a case that can be made that everything else that we've discussed, like around the valuation, it makes it worthwhile, right? But it's really this notion of supply and demand that people should be prepared for. I've mentioned before how investing in AMD, for example, the last 7 years has been a crazy roller coaster. Investing in semiconductor stocks is not for everyone. Fundamentals are going to be volatile, and so the stock price.
Right. And before you do make a case, you have to consider the fact that many things can go wrong. We have existing competitors, for example, AMD and Qualcomm are pushing to do better in the space. We have customers shifting in-house. You talked about the CSPs. The biggest tech companies like Microsoft, Alphabet, and Amazon are building solutions internally to also be self-reliant. And then we have new entrants. Bloomberg reported SoftBank founder and CEO Masayoshi Son has a $100 billion plan to boost the global supply of AI-focused processors. And if you haven't heard already, OpenAI founder Sam Altman seeks to raise $7 trillion with a T for a new AI chip project. Finally, macro factors, economic downturns, export controls, supply chain disruptions. These could challenge the growth story.
So the bottom line is that NVIDIA is not for the faint of heart if you consider all these risks, right? But profitable industries, as you can see with NVIDIA's margin, they tend to attract competition. So there's going to be a very fast changing environment for everyone involved. And historically speaking, we know that it may lead to mean reversion for the leaders in the space. So that's something to keep in mind.
Yeah, and one of the main questions that will define NVIDIA's future is how sustainable the demand for generative AI will be. But a few days ago, OpenAI announced its latest AI video model called Sora, generating realistic videos up to a minute long from a text prompt. So this demand probably isn't slowing down anytime soon, and a lot of companies are going to need a lot of GPUs.
That's exactly right. We've been fascinated by just the rise in AI-generated videos. That's a perfect example of entirely new industry popping up that we did not expect a few years ago. And so as this unfold, the story around the demand for NVIDIA's product really, like, the addressable market and the increased demand is now a clear story when you consider that. If you want to learn more about Sora, we dropped a new video on our YouTube channel that breaks down everything you must know. And so we're pretty excited about this one. So take a look.
See you there.